Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. We'd like to welcome you to the service of songs for our mother, darling Osayamo Kayode Sofola. Osayamo means God's own child. All through this week, I've been doing a lot of reading of God's work, a lot of poetry. I read something from Maya Angelou, which said, I have learned that people will forget what you have said. People will forget what you have done. But people will never forget how you made them feel. In this world that we live in today, my mother was a bright light. A light that entered many rooms and many hearts and turned darkness into positive things. She was there for lots of her friends, but most of all, she was there for us, her family. All week, we have been overwhelmed by the calls, the messages, the emails, the texts, the WhatsApps and the Instagrams, everything possible, from Nigeria to America to China, from lawyers to presidents, ex-presidents, to people who are selling fish in the market, all saying the same thing. Your mother was an angel. She touched us dearly. And you know, as her children, we sort of think it's an exclusive feeling to us. But we realized during this moment that we were not very exclusive, that our mother was an angel to a lot of people. She was many things to a lot of people, but she was first of all an honorable and loving wife to my father, a beautiful and devoted mother to us. She was a caring and unrelentless friend to all her friends and her family. She would always go to Professor Osato's house and sit next to him and talk. She would always talk about her brother, Uncle Mudami, Auntie Ashi, and all her family members daily, and all her friends. She was a teacher. She was a businesswoman, a thorough entrepreneur. She was our mother, and most of all, she was a child of God. You know, my brother told me one thing, my older brother Kolade, he said, this would have been the same feeling we would have had today if we were 90. And you know what? That was such a wise word for me at the time. And I didn't understand it till today. When I was younger, my grandfather, the late Chief Frank Geosage, passed. And my mother was inconsolable. My then late grandfather, Kehinde Sofola, came and consoled her. We went to Benin City for the funeral service, and then I saw everybody dancing and celebrating. So I pulled my mother aside, I must have been five, and I asked her, Mom, what's going on here? Why are they celebrating? Papa is dead. She said, ah, Papa lived a full life, a celebrated and full life, and he did great things with his life. So we must celebrate him. It's with the same energy that I celebrate my mother. 65 years she lived is more than 500 years most people will live. What my mother did in 1 year, people cannot do in 10 years. My mother could organize, she could pull people together, she could raise people's spirits, and she could talk to her God. I know she's here today looking down on all of you and all of us, and she's proud of all of you. I know she's going to be in heaven organizing angels for all of you to perform your miracles as she does best. And I know she's going to be in the hearts of my brothers and sisters and my children and their children who will come. So today, please, we don't want any crying, we don't want any soberness, we don't want anyone's faces being long. We want you to celebrate the life of the mother and sing with her as she's here singing with you in praise of a beautiful life, well lived, and a race well run. Thank you.
Can we all rise up as we honor God by a short prayer? Father, we thank you for the comfort your word will bring as we invite you, we invite your holy presence, your Holy Spirit to dwell in the midst of all of us this evening. You are sovereign. You are a sovereign God. And who are we to question you? Because nothing happens unless you permit it. As your word says in the book of Isaiah 43 from verse 2, when we pass through the waters, you will be with us. When we pass through the rivers, they will not sweep us. When we walk through the fire, we will not be burned. The flames will not consume us or set us ablaze, because you are Lord, our God, the Holy One of Israel, and our Savior. Our hearts may be heavy this evening, but nonetheless, Father, we trust you. And in faith, we believe that not only is it well with us, all will be well. Father, you will make all things beautiful in your own time. Father, heal our pain. Comfort us this evening. Lift our spirits and strengthen us to bear this loss. Where, O death, is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Because, Father, we thank you. We thank you today because our sister darling has passed in Christ, and she has been transformed to live with you forever. We pray that one day we also will be transformed to live with you forever because of the victory we have in you over death. And in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I now invite the choir, Lively Stones, Choir of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the King's Court Parish, to take us in the opening praise and worship.
Hallelujah. Can you clap your hands together for Jesus if you're happy to be here today?
Hallelujah. Ega digi akata, akata ya, akati obane mima, akata ya, akati obane mima, onrebe ya, ega digi nebe mo, isi ikedu, ega digi akata. Akakaya. done for me, what no man can do. You have done for me what no man can do. You have done for me what no man can do. You have done for me. Sing Jesus, Jesus. You are so, Baba, you are so good.
Jesus, you are so good.
What no man can do.
You have done.
What no man can do. What my Father cannot do, you have done it for me.
What no man can do.
Oh, you
have
done. Two more times. Oh, Jesus. Oh,
you
are
so good.
Jesus, you are so good.
Jesus,
you are so, so good.
What no man
can do. What no man can do. Oh, you have done for us what no man can do.
You have done
for us what no man can do. Oh, for the last time, everybody lift up your voice. Jesus,
Jesus.
Oh, you are
so good.
My Savior, you are so good.
Jesus.
So what no man,
what no man can do.
Oh, you have done for me
what no man can do.
Oh, you have done for me
what no man can do.
Oh, you have done for me
what no man can do.
Of our hands in worship.
You are Alpha and Omega. You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. And Omega, we worship you, our Lord. You are worthy,
you are worthy to be praised.
We give you all, we give you all, we give you all. Everybody, lift up your hands to Him. We give you all, we give you all, we give you all.
You have done,
thank you.
Verses 1 to 8. And immediately we will take the hymn, Amazing Grace, in Christ Alone, sitting.
Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 to 8. To everything there is a season, and a time for every purpose under the sun, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which has been planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Christ, in Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, the gift of love and righteousness, stung by the wounds he came to save, till on the cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I lay. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since God has lost his grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, but with the precious blood of Christ.
Faithful standing. Great is that standing.
And love.
The second scripture reading of this day from the book of Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 13 to 18, will be taken by Mrs. Bukial.
To be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others, which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring to him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. This is the word of the Lord.
Can I now call on Professor Osato Gewa Osage to say a few words about Sister Darlene Shofola?
It's not usually a happy occasion for one to be talking about one's junior. I'm far older than Darlene, and I cannot come to the funeral on Saturday. I'm not by tradition as a Benin man and as a chief. Allowed to be at her funeral. I was present when Darlene was born in Kaduna. I remember the day very well. We were living in the GRA in Kaduna, and it was a home delivery. Mama was in labor in the bedroom, being looked after by being looked after by Mrs. Ukwama, who was a Calabar lady married to Engineer Ukwama. In the sitting room was my father and his friend, who later became Major General Agwiye Nronsi. I think Agwiye Nronsi was probably a captain or a major at that time. They were drinking away, and I was in the couch looking at them and hearing the moans and groans of the laboring woman. I didn't know that I would later get very used to hearing the moans and groans of laboring women. Maybe that's where my interest started. And when she was born, the two men gave themselves another drink, and the fried chicken and so on came out from the kitchen. Of course, I shared in that. The loss of Yamo means a lot to many people. I have been pleasantly surprised to the huge followers she has from all over the world. She was always a very determined and combative person. You can't say something wrong or do something wrong and then she will keep quiet about it. She will fight. And what always amazed me was that after she's told me all her quarrels with Mrs. So-so-so or Ms. So-so-so, a month later, I see them laughing together and gisting. So it became quite clear to me that I should just be an observer of her relationships. She was a fearless fighter, highly intelligent. It might interest you that this house you are all looking here, Nyama was the uncertified architect. She was the one that was altering whatever the architect had drawn and said, do it this way, do it that way, et cetera, et cetera. And look at what they produced. And whenever we had to draft an advert, it was usually Nyamo that drafted it. She would draft it in consultation with URA in particular, and then they would pass it to me for final approval. So I don't know how they managed to do her own advert this time. I don't know who did it. And so that's another aspect of her career, of her life. As was stated in her biography and said earlier, she was a teacher, a business person, very versatile. If she starts a business now and it doesn't work, she just moves to another one. So you find her running the school, running catering, selling fabrics, almost becoming an event planner. She was the number one party organizer in our family. And as I said to somebody, if it was somebody else that died and Nyama was alive, she will make sure that we do this sort of thing we are doing now. She will not be put off by any COVID, anything. We have spacing. We have masks. And we are all here. And God will continue to protect us. I myself had COVID. In June of this year, I was in Luth for 12 nights in isolation. With COVID that had been misdiagnosed by everybody, as is the usual case, if I see that Lagos State, in today's this day, the governor is saying that if you think you have malaria, you should assume you have COVID. I was treating COVID for 6 days. I was treating malaria for 6 days. Then the chief executive of Teaching Hospital Idiaraba called me because he worked with me for years. He said, this your malaria has gone on for too long. I'm sending an ambulance to bring you to Luth. I was sitting by my wife in the sitting room. The ambulance arrived with about five people, two other vehicles, and they carried me off to Luth. And that night, they diagnosed that I had COVID. So in Yamo's case, some lab was giving her COVID negative. That's what I was told. Because myself and my brother, Mudiame, who are both doctors, we were saying, what's the COVID test result? They told her, negative. Everybody were put off. But her husband, Kayode, has moved long enough with doctors. The next thing I heard from him was that, Sato, Yamo's oxygen is 49%. We must take her to hospital. That's how the journey started. So we mobilized, myself and Mudiame, and the doctor on duty at my hospital that night, three of us, we all ended up with them at the hospital. But that's interesting. But in the final analysis, as some people have told me, it went that way because God wanted it to go that way. So one should not dwell too much on the journey. I was expecting her to be discharged on Monday, and she died on Sunday. I asked God to do me that one favor. Let me hear tomorrow that this woman is alive and breathing. And she says, "Laloke, brother," who is the way she would normally greet me. It was not like that. She has strength of character. She was always willing to join people. If you are rejoicing, she'll be there with you if she's your friend. If you are regret about something, Yamo will be there. And she was lucky she had a husband who was focusing on legal practice. And so she had opportunity and time to do whatever she wanted to do. So with all these years that they've lived together harmoniously, we have never been called into their home to settle any quarrel. In 40, 41 years. And so that tells you that, not that they didn't quarrel, but they never carried their quarrel out. So I'm pained to think about what he is going through right now. Because even when, if my wife travels for 3-4 weeks, I know how I feel. When I went to Harvard in 1998 for 6 weeks, I had to get my sisters, led by Yamo, to go and convince my wife to come to Boston. And people were saying, people want to go to America. Your husband say you should come. You don't want to go. My wife didn't want to go. She doesn't like traveling. But she convinced her, or this, my sisters convinced her, go and meet your husband. And she came to Boston, let alone somebody you've lived together for 40 years. She's a fearless fighter. When you need an army, she was almost a one-woman army. And she will be at the front with her chest if she's convinced that what you are doing is correct. When I was ill, I don't know which major pastor in Lagos State she didn't phone to tell them that her brother is ill. I know she did because they were phoning me to be praying for me, people that I didn't know. I had gone. Samu Jame followed. It was Yamo's turn to go to England. And shocks, she said, I'm not going. Was offered a chance to go and study England university level. She said she's not going, that she's going to Ibadan. Later on, when I was discussing with her, I said, how did you make that decision? She said, well, that she doesn't want to go to England, and every month she's waiting for allowance. Now she's in Ibadan. Just a phone call, and the money will come through, or somebody is sent. That was a very major decision to make, to decide that you don't want to go to England to study. So she stayed in Ibadan, did well in Ibadan. Just before her final exam, her elder sister Dorothy was very ill and died in UCH. And she used to go every day to sit by her sister. And from there, she moved back to Lagos. And that same singleness of mind has marked whatever she has done. Bringing up of her children, you know, they've all done very well. And when you look at it, she was 65 and a half years old with three male giants and a woman that is like a man in everything. What else did we want her to do that she has not yet done? Nothing. So her owner called time on her. And when we were thinking she would come out of hospital, he said, all right, time is up, come home. So she has left her mark. She married a gentleman, a King's College old boy, who immediately told my father he was a King's College old boy. My father said, oh, approved, approved. No more questions. And that's how he has been. A very reliable in-law in the family. My sisters are very clever. They don't marry any troublesome man. All their husbands are quiet. If you see a man married to a Giwa or Sage female who is loud and troublesome, please let me know. Is it Akin? Was it the late Kayode? Or is it Jenkins Coker? They all go for men who are quiet and determined and succeed in their profession. Kayode Shufola has been SAN for 25 years plus. I know because I gave a speech when he had a party at the Federal Palace to mark his SAN. So I'm sure most of my brothers who were in Nigeria were there. So Kayode, you are the one that we should really condole. When you lie on your big bed all alone, I know, because I lie on my own big bed alone whenever my wife travels for more than 1 week, and I feel it. So I know how you will feel. But just console yourself by saying what I said. What else did we want her to do that she hasn't done? 1, 2, 3, 4 graduates and masters as well. You know, they are there as Gidigba. So there's really nothing else. Enjoyment, she was there. They are signaling me to stop talking. I always warn people that I'm a teacher and a professor. We talk. So she took us to Spain for birthday. Took us to Morocco for birthday. after she had taken us to Sri Lanka, where we took over a whole hotel. And I think I saw the leader of the band. He came here earlier on. By the time we left Sri Lanka, all the parents there wanted their daughters to marry Nigerians. But after Morocco, I told my sister, I said, enough is enough. Don't call us to any out of station parties anymore. So I'll tell you now that if you call me, I won't come. Too much enjoyment can kill somebody. So I'll miss her. The husband knows. When their phone rings at 11:30, 12, he knows it's me. We must talk every day. So, Yamo, rest in peace. We thank you for what God has allowed you to do here. We ask God to be with the family. Guard and guide them. My sister made enemies because of her strong character. I know. So anybody that was her enemy, you just assume that I know about you. But in spite of all that, we thank God for everything. Enmity has ended. God has said enmity has ended, and so shall it be. We shall all be rejoicing after this. And coronavirus, we are instructing you now in God's name. Go back to China. Thank you.
Can I now invite Mrs. Bola Amu to say a few things about Sister Darlene Shefola in 2 minutes?
This is really hard for me. I do better at internalizing my emotions. How can I talk publicly now about Osayama? And in the past tense, I wish it was a birthday, a wedding, celebration of an achievement, something joyful. But it had to be this. Osayama's passing. Unto glory, yes. But why? I have a right to question God, and I have been asking him. Since Sunday noon, I don't want those simple answers where they say the good pass on early. I want my personal revelation. Why my sister, my best friend, Osayama, had to go. Don't worry, we were many besties. If men and medicine, I quote my senior brother, Professor Atasto, my father's firstborn, by another man. If men and medicine were not enough, what about love? What about prayers? Why were these not strong enough to give her overcoming power in this illness? I am still waiting on the Lord for my answer. But I take courage from the word of God in the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 7. Only be thou strong and very courageous. Osayama was first my sister and then my friend. A very intimate and mostly private relationship. A relationship that involved both our families. She had always been a part of my life. Memory fails me. At which point in our lives we became sisters, but it was very early on. I will skip our growing up years. Prof dealt with that, and start at after national service, where we both served as accounting trainees at Coopers and Lybrand. We both got married and had our first babies while we were training, but we're both too immature to manage the training along with our marital lives. We opted out. Thank God, no regrets. I pause to remember how we were constantly gulping at Balumo in the office to satisfy our first pregnancy cravings. Osayamo was my chief bridesmaid at my small wedding. She had a large one in Benin and Lagos a couple of months later. And we had our first babies within a month of each other, Kolade and Oluyemi. I'm not going to tell you Osayamo was perfect, excellent, or flawless. No. No human being can be. But she had come into the true knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Her gifts of grace began to manifest increasingly. This is where I get to her first big gift. She never discriminated amongst her friends. These friends covered a wide scope. And hearing this one, another gift was manifest. Each friend was made to feel special, like you were the only one or the best. Not an easy feat amongst women. Osayamo was warm, hospitable, caring, kind, and very considerate. She had, through her life's journey, become a woman of means, but she was easily comfortable and accommodating of friends less fortunate. Osayamo knew how to love and show love. People were drawn to her like bees to honey. Osayamo was industrious, enterprising, juggling several businesses together effortlessly. I found it amazing. She was undeterred by failures. No time or desire to sit down and cry at the failure of any project. She was on to the next, and always investing her best energies and resources, regardless of the outcome. We had so many private, intimate discussions on these issues, but press on she did until her illness. What about her smile? So sweet. Lips firmly fixed together, so unique. And she was extremely photogenic, something I never failed to tell her. An exuberant spirit, ever put off by people's odd behaviors towards her. Osayamo loved social media. I don't. Her contact list, inexhaustible. We shared a couple of platforms together, and she was online from dusk to dawn. I had to ask her when she slept. She sat between dawn and 11 a.m. She was continually posting stuff, educational, entertaining, newsworthy, whatever. And some thought she was too much in their face. Wherever she called me to let off her outrage at those who did, I simply tell her to go on doing what makes her happy at this stage and age of our lives. Now she's gone. I dare anyone to pick up that gauntlet and do the research required to give the postings like she did. Osayamo loved elaborate jewelry. I got the courage to use them through her influence. Ha! Osayamo lived fast and furious in the last couple of years? Was the good Lord preparing her for an early departure from Cyprus to Mabea to Morocco? She was carrying everyone along to celebrate with herself and her family. I did not and could not attend any of her destination events, but Asayamo kept me posted of daily events. She clogged my phone with photos and news. She wanted me to feel a part of it. I'm sure she did the same to some other friends. A family woman, Osayamo's children were her pride and joy, her treasures. Nothing was spared in love, care, and provision to make them excel. And her husband, her precious son, she bombarded her ears with Kayode's name. Kayode this, Kayode that, son, all in love. They were a close and loving couple. Osayamo's missives were always signed Kayode and Dali. To Kayode, she was Nyamo. She was always wanting to celebrate her husband. His Valentine's birthday is just around the corner. Let the good Lord strengthen you with all the strength of the resurrection, son. Her siblings are crushed to the core, especially following the passing on of two other sisters, Zeze and Bobo, for whom Osayamo cared exceedingly. She left behind a very crippled me. I communicated with her until the 1st of January, after which all calls went unanswered. But our prayer group went on till that fateful morning. Kayode, Kolade, Jumon, Buki, Oladipo. I can only continue to pray that the good Lord be your buckler, your strength, your strong tower to see you through this period of pain, focusing on joyful memories. Again, I leave you with the word of God in Isaiah 35, verse 4. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not, behold, your God will come. Ha! Osayamo, you are not here, but your presence lingers in the shadows. You don't see what we see, but we hear you laughing with us when we laugh. You know what we feel, but we feel you feeling for us. Fare thee well, Osayamo. Rest in peace and rise to glory. Thank you all so much for being a part of this celebration and your support for her family. God bless you.
We'll now take the special number of the Holy City by the Praise Choral.
Last night I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing and ever us the song. Methought the voice of angels
plunge, my dreams was changed, the streets no longer rang. Hushed with the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with misery, the moon was cold and chill, as a shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As a shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were open wide, and all who would might enter. Was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing for the light is on.
Hello again, everyone. So I wanted to say a few words about my mom, so I asked you to please just give me a little bit of patience while I try and explain our relationship and explain her to you from my perspective. You often hear people, when their loved ones die, say to you, they were shocked to find out how many people loved them, or they didn't know how much good they had been doing. I don't have one of these stories to share with you. The reason why is simple. My mother, Darling Osayama Shofola, was an open book. When she was happy, you would know it. When you crossed her, you would not need an interpreter. She would let you know. My mother would help anyone who came to her, and she would gladly share whatever she had. You see, my mother liked the nice things in life, but she never prioritized material things. Over the last few days, I have comforted people all over the world. People are distraught, they are hurt, they are inconsolable. All of them saying to me, "But do you know what darling did for me? Do you know how she was there for me?" The truth is, I don't know their individual stories, but I do know my mother. My mother delighted in the happiness of other people. She sought it out, she nurtured it, she encouraged it. Both my parents have a special joy they derive from seeing other people do well. My mother encouraged everyone around her. She encouraged them in their personal lives. She encouraged them in their spiritual lives. My mother was forever handing out prayer manuals. You think she have a printing press in the house. She encouraged people in their financial lives, in their business lives. My mother was a woman with a rare kind of determination. When she decided she was going to achieve something, no matter how improbable or impossible it seemed on day one, she would pray, plan it, and simply trust in God and go ahead. Sometimes these things went brilliantly and it was something to behold. And sometimes she was disappointed. But my mother never let disappointment stop her from believing in herself or stop her from believing in God and trying again. My mother was a woman of plans, bullet points, lists. Every morning before the crack of dawn, she was up with a pen and a pad and she was plotting. On particularly industrious days where she had finished plotting for herself, you might turn to her list and see subheadings that said, Kayode, underline, Kolade, Buki, Juwon, Dikbo, new titles. Once you found yourself on my mom's list, you could be sure that you are going to stay there until she had got you to do what she wanted. God help you the morning you moved up to highlighters or asterisks on my mother's list. You'll be sure to hear from her several times that day until she has gotten that job done. You see, my mother did everything with intensity, with a fullness of herself. She was not an uncertain person. She loved intensely. She worked intensely. She gave intensely. And those of you who joined us in Sri Lanka or Marbella or Marrakesh will attest, my mother also had fun intensely. She was deliberate about doing everything to the best of her ability and doing everything in her own way. Her business acumen was unparalleled. She saw opportunities in all situations, and more often than not, she would try to seize them. I confess that I have no idea how I can be standing here today discussing my mother in past tense. Indeed, I have been known to burst into tears at the idea of my mother returning to Nigeria at the end of a summer holiday. My mother was not just my mommy. She was not just my friend. She was my best friend. I found myself in a confusing and circular situation at the start of this week, facing the greatest upheaval of my life. I had just lost my best friend. I kept returning to my phone at intervals, thinking, I simply must call mommy and tell her that she has passed on. While I am grateful for the support and wishes that we have received from everyone, what has struck me in this time is that we humans have a bizarre preoccupation with the length of years that we spend. There is this assumption that a longer life is in some way better and a shorter life is tragic. I'm sorry to say that I find this overly simplistic. The best and most important life that has ever been lived, if you ask me, is the life of my Lord Jesus Christ. He did not enter his old age. My mother's life reminds me of the parable in Matthew 25 of the master who entrusted his servants with bags of gold. We are all entrusted with bags of time, and we will give account for how we spend each unit of that time. My mother spent each unit wisely. Every day she tried harder, every day she did more, and every day my mother helped more people. whether a life contains 50 years or 100, it is by how it is lived that it should be measured. My mother fit into hours what others would in days. She fit into days what others would in months. And she fit into months what others did in years. She lived a life filled with pursuits and adventures. She took the gift of each day as exactly that, a precious blessing from God. And she invested it wisely. My mother's perspectives on issues was a blessing to us as a family and to others as well. Her intellect and perception were so dynamic as to be almost otherworldly. Indeed, my brothers and I joked sadly that God must have had a special project in heaven and he thought Osayamo is the one. My mother didn't see problems. She had faith and she saw solutions. She didn't see obstacles. She saw maneuvers and she moved around them. She had this fierce optimism that was founded on nothing other than the knowledge that with God, all things are possible. And with him, they surely were. We saw answered prayers. We saw miracles when our mother got on her knees. I take a lot of comfort from the way my mother lived her life. She did everything with passion. She was bold and she was truthful. And for many, sometimes that truth hurt. But I am proud that she always spoke the truth. She was passionate and she was caring. She was kind and she was forgiving. When she saw me falling out with a friend, she would pull me aside and say, "Bookie, nobody is perfect, including you. You cannot throw people away because of imperfections." People say that if you want to know who a person really is, come and meet them on a day of trials and challenges. The harder moments in life will refine you. As I look at my brothers, Kolade Junwo Dikpo, my husband, Lanre, and my sister, Natalie, going through this time, as we walk through this period, I see each of us more clearly. And I see in each of us more darling Osayamo Shofola, more and more clearly each day as well. I am a corporate lawyer. My specialism is international mergers and acquisitions. Basically, I package for sale or purchase, investments or companies. But my husband has a running joke where he says he doesn't know what I am. He says I am always looking for the next business idea. I tell him it is because I am the daughter of an entrepreneur and a trader. At university, my mother would bring things to halls to sell to her coursemates. And my friends in Queen's College would testify to the cottage industry I started selling imported items there. When my husband queries the inordinate amount of time that I spend organizing children's events or creating educational materials, I tell him, I am the daughter of a teacher, and I grew up in my mother's nursery school. When I perplex him with my ideas for floor plans, and I say, baby, we will take down this wall, and we will do this and do that, I tell him I am the daughter of a woman with an exceptional sense of design, who developed this house and much more besides it. I am darling's daughter, and the knowledge of how much my mother has poured into me, how much my mother has poured into this world, it simply softens the blow of the physical loss. What can I say about my mother? A mother I spoke to every morning before work. A mother who called me every lunchtime to see how the morning went. Who called me every evening to see what had happened since lunch. Who called me at night so we could strategize our bedtime for what was coming in the day ahead. Can I say that she has not said enough? Can I say that I have not learned enough? Can I say that she has not done enough? None of these things will be true. Every morning, praise filled my mother's room. Her faith was unpretentious, and it was effortlessly shared. Her love for Pastor Nathaniel Bassey meant that even my Muslim father knew all the words to his songs. Over the last few weeks, my brothers and I fell into a quiet, agreed arrangement. One, we would be with mommy. Two, we would love our mommy. Three, we would intercede and pray for mommy. Four, we would surround our mother with praise. When it came to praise, our mom only ever had one request. Two words, Nathaniel Bassey. On the morning she left us physically, we did the same thing. and we still do the same thing now. We surround ourselves with praise, and we seek the presence of God, because that is indeed where our mother is now. A daughter of the Most High God, a follower of Jesus Christ, who lived every day to her best, has been called by the God who loves her, whose presence she delighted in. Those of us that she has left behind, Kolade, Juwon, Dikpo, my father, Lanre, Natalie, we can only do one thing. We can only say, hallelujah. Thank you, God, for the race that my mother ran, for the love that she covered us with, for the prayers that my mother said. Do you know how my mother could pray? She covered us with her strength, and we are standing in it. My brothers and I would never be ready to be without our mother. But if I reflect and I tell you the truth, we have been ready for a very long time. This is because everything my mother did, including raising us, she did intentionally and she did with intensity. She raised us to be ready for this moment. I know where my mother is, and I give God the glory.
We now have the last tribute by Mrs. Bimbo Dada.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let me start by thanking Buki for that her wonderful tribute. And I really don't know what else anybody else can say about Yamo, because Buki actually summarized everything about my darling friend. My tribute is to a friend of almost 53 years and the wife of my husband's besto. Because I met Darling in 1968 when she joined us in Queen's School in Form 2. Dark-skinned, pretty, slim, unbelievable, we were all slim once upon a time. And she had that wonderful signature smile that captivated everybody. Darling was my friend then. As you know, all we Lagos girls schooling in Ibadan, we had a chip on our shoulder, so we were all friends. And that was how I was friend with Darling up till when I left in 1971. Darling went to UI, I went to University of Ife, and our paths hardly crossed until 1980, when I met my husband-to-be, Bolahan, whose best friend happens to be Darling's husband. And when we met, Darling was the go-between, the Alarino. Bimbo was my classmate, Bimbo was this, Bimbo was that. That was how our friendship took another turn. And since we got married, I stopped being Bimbola. I became princess, with an emphasis on this. Darling was a loving person. I don't want to go about her character. We have said enough of that, and have been warned to try and make it short. That's why I didn't even bring my phone or any notes. Darling, one thing I have to say about Darling is that whatever Darling had, Darling wanted everybody to have. Darling would say, Bimbola, St. Saviour's, I heard it's a very good school. That's where our children must go. And I'll laugh. I said, Darling, I went to St. Saviour's. He said, you went to St. Saviour's? I knew it. Our children must go to St. Saviour's. Darling will say, they are selling land somewhere. I think we should buy. I don't want to go on and on, but definitely what Darling had, Darling wanted everybody to have. Darling was a very caring person, very generous, very fun. Darling never took no for an answer. Ah, Juwan is getting married in Sri Lanka. I said, you know you are going. I said, do I have a choice? I said, you don't have a choice, so princess, you and prince, you must go. I'm doing my birthday, you must go. So I didn't even, after a while, I stopped even trying to argue with Darling because I knew I had to go. Not only will you go, we are staying in this hotel. You and prince, you must stay with me in this hotel. Darling gave the, and we could all see that all these were out of love. Just pure love. Because I know Darling has so many friends, but when Darling singles you out, Darling will even, I know that people say that Darling makes sure you feel special, but I know I was special. I know that we were special because Darling would come and make sure that we were very close. You know Kayode and Gbolaho now. So that was our relationship. In November last year, my husband and I met Kayode and Darling at a church function. And Darling said that, Mimbola Gbolaho, we have not seen for so long. Yeah, come over now. This pandemic, we've been in lockdown. Come over to the house. Oh, I said, I like to go. When I go to church, I want to go home. I don't like going about. I said, don't, just come. So we came. By the time we entered the kitchen, princess, oh yeah, you be cutting this, I'll be cutting this. Darling had it spread for us. Shrimps, everything, we ate. After that, we sat on the table and we gisted and we talked. We spent almost 4 hours here. I never dreamt that would be the last time I'll see my darling friend. What if I hadn't gone that day, I would not have forgiven myself. When Darling hosted us here, our classmates, we ate. We packed, our drivers packed home, souvenirs, Inko, Darling in hand, and her business ideas. So many, but I won't repeat Bookie. I know, I just want to make it short because if I go on and on, we will not leave this place. But I just want to say that Darling's departure is a shock. It's a shock to all of us, my classmates. The first day on Sunday, coming back from church that I had, I cried. My driver did not even know how to beg me. The driver came and said, Mommy, what is happening? I cried. Yamo has, she was just looking at me. Then I said, Mrs. Shofola, I said, that mommy? He almost started crying because Darling was and is and will ever be a magnanimous person. About 2 weeks ago, my daughter Tutu was saying that, that she's turning 3 next month, that she's planning a photo shoot, she'll wear the dress for her and send it to Auntie Darling, that the first time she wore the other dress, that expensive beauty Darling didn't do anything small, she did it big, she did it with love. All my children were her children. I don't know how Kayode is going to manage, but God knows. God gives strength, and I know he's going to strengthen you. Kolade, Juwon, Buki, Dipo, I know God is with you. As Buki has said, she has indirectly prepared you for her departure. She did not prepare us in our class, so, because we are saying that, who's going to be giving us all this historical information, all this long gone music of long years, so many information, history. That was when she stopped posting. Everybody kept saying, what is happening to Darling? What is happening to Darling? When did you hear about Darling last? I called before, I think it was on the 1st or the 2nd, I got a text from her that she was in hospital. I was so worried, I called. Luckily, Dipo answered me and gave me information. And since then, I'm sure Dipo was tired of my questioning. But so people kept asking, have you heard from Darling? It was difficult for me to keep it to myself. But we prayed. We have a prayer group in my class, and we prayed and we prayed and we prayed. But we've had Darling for almost 66 years. She's just 2 months older than me. We've had her for so long, and I think Jesus, God, the angels wanted her with them and took her back. So all I can say is that we have no choice but manage without Darling. But let the beautiful memories she left behind comfort us. Let her ideals, her determination, the good things about her, let them guide us all. Let us remember her with love. When I came here, I sat down and I cried. I cried around. I've cried so much that I can't. I now realize that when you cry, it affects your sight. I find it difficult to read. But anyway, I don't want to go on and on. I just want us to know that Darling is definitely in a better place, and God will keep and strengthen each and every one of us. Let us take heart and know that God knows best, and God will always do the best. Thank you very much.
Our last scripture reading for this evening will be taken by Dipo Shofola from the book of John 11, verses 25 and 26.
Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? This is the word of the Lord.
May I at this junction now invite Pastor Nathaniel Bassi to lead us in a special ministration. Pastor Nathaniel Bassi is the pastor of the Oasis. Oasis is a parish of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the King's Court Chapel. Pastor Nathaniel, before you minister me, I thank you for honoring this invitation. On Sunday, when our boss and our mentor called me and he said to me that, Jide, there's something you must do for me. You must please get me Pastor Nathaniel Bassi. Shadia and I rushed to church, and Pastor had just finished ministry. And he said to us that, I'm sorry, I do not do this anymore. It was impossible, but we knew that with God all things are possible. And we thank you for creating that exception by honoring our boss, our mentor, and his family, and us. I understand that Sister Darling was your fan, and all your songs were her favorites. And I hope that you will bless us this evening. Thank you.
Hallelujah. I'm actually happy to be here to sing, you know, and celebrate the life of someone who really loved our ministry. The Bible says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the saints. You are God from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. You are the living God. You are God from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. Oh, you are the living God. You are God
That the 420 elders, they cast their crowns. Our sisters is in heaven casting her crowns at the feet of our Maker. And she's just singing, casting crowns, lifting hands, bowing up is all I've come to do. Casting crowns. Lifting her, bowing her, is all I've come to do. Casting crowns,
casting crowns,
lifting her,
Praise God. It's now time for the word. And to share the word with us this evening for a few minutes is our pastor, senior pastor, Pastor David Oyegbemo of the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the Oakwood Parish here in Lekki.
Thank you very much, sir. I'm just a junior pastor, I'm not senior. Good evening, everyone. And I know that you will still get a vote of thanks, but thank you for coming as well. Good evening to the family of the Shofolas. I have heard so much about you, and more recently from Pastor Jide Boku, who is a very, very somebody I respect a lot. And there's so much to that that I won't say here right now. Shall we pray? Our Father and our God, we want to say thank you to you. For your word says to us that in everything we should give thanks, that that's your will for us in Christ Jesus. If we don't know your will for us in many things, we know in this one, and you were clear about it, that in Christ Jesus, your will for us is that in everything we give thanks. So, Lord, we give you thanks, and we appreciate you, Almighty God. We give you all the glory for our gathering even here today. It is not by mistake that anyone is here today. You have ordained this day even before the world was founded. Father, we ask that, Lord, you will speak to us in Jesus' mighty name. The encouragement required for this day, O Lord, for each and every one, Father, grant in Jesus' mighty name. The wisdom we need, O Lord, to take away from this place today, for your word says that it's important for us to put our heart in path of wisdom. Grant unto us, Almighty God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Give power to your word. Let the entrance of your word give us light and add wisdom unto us. Let your word be the light in our path, O Lord, and the lamp to our feet, that even in this world of darkness, we will not grope, we will not fail, we will not fall, we will not falter, because your light will provide the guidance that we need. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, every encouragement required, Father, grant unto us, Almighty God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. I think a lot has been said this evening, and I said to Pastor Jide as we were sitting down there, I said, the message for today has been preached. I must really appreciate Mrs. And please, if I miss anything, please correct me, Mrs. Buki Alakija. You actually preached. Thank you so much. Two reasons we come to place events like this is to, one, encourage the bereaved family, and two, encourage ourselves, but also put our heart in the path of wisdom. As for encouraging the family themselves have encouraged us. So there's not much to do in that. But we trust the Holy Spirit, who is a comforter with words that man cannot speak. Because sometimes men speak, and what they say actually hurt more than console. And I can tell you that in a space of 8 months, between August 2018 and March 2019, I lost two key women in my life. My mom passed 7th August 2018, and the person that supported me and did all the planning and everything of all the funeral and everything like that, March 28, 2019, also passed, my wife. And so sometimes people say to you, we have a sense of what you are going through. They don't. So sometimes I say to people, you know, when you go to commiserate, sometimes just keeping quiet and just watching sometimes helps more than just sometimes just say some things for the sake of saying or filling the gap. Pastor Nathaniel said something. He said, precious to God, precious in the sight of God is the death of his saints. Psalm 115, verse 16. But Isaiah said something, Isaiah 57 verse 1. He says, the righteous die and no one takes it to heart. He said, people don't know that God is taking the righteous away, sparing them from the evil to come. Our sister, mother, wife of our dear father sitting down there has passed on. And one of her friends said she would want to know the reason. I will preface this message by saying that God did not take permission from anyone to create anyone. He owes us no explanation as to when he takes anyone. And what I'll be sharing with you is a few nuggets from what came directly from God to encourage me in my own time of grief. I didn't ask you before I created. Why should I ask? Why should I ask from you or take permission from you before I take? The prerogative is mine, and that's why I'm God. I'm sovereign in everything. God is sovereign in everything. And to be sovereign means can take decisions, can take actions, and nobody can question. And that's why, in a very deep word that Yorubas have, they call it kabiosi. That is, nobody can question you. And even if you do, and he doesn't answer you, what can you say? And who can you report him to? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, if you read 13 to 18, I will not be reading, I'll just be paraphrasing through. Apostle Paul enjoins us, when things like this happen, not to sorrow too much. Why? We're not hopeless. We're not. He says, brothers and sisters, we don't want you to be uninformed. Don't be uninformed. Don't be ignorant about those who sleep in death. Do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. We have hope. For we know that the person who has passed on in Christ. And I've had a lot, even this evening, from all the tributes and testimonies about her. We have hope. And every time this happens, believe me sincerely, it puts the rest of us on the race. Because the person who has passed on, and we know, going by the Bible, what the scripture tells us, that they have gone to meet with the Lord, the challenge is for us, those who are alive, to make it to heaven. Because let me tell you, people, every day puts a challenge to our faith. A challenge that sometimes, if care is not taken, it's not how long being a Christian can sweep you off your feet. So it's for us who are still here to do everything possible by God's grace to join those who have gone. For them, they have finished the race. And the way they have finished, we can tell straight away that they have gone to be with the Lord. How will our own be? And I think that's the wisdom we want to take away from a time and events like this. Ecclesiastes 3, we've read the 1-8, one of the first Bible reads that was taken. Life is about purpose. In verse 1, it says, to everything there's a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. So the essence of life is predicated on the purpose for which it was given. The purpose it is meant to achieve. Life is an investment of the Creator, the Almighty God, in every human being for a purpose. Nobody was given life, just go and squander and come back like a prodigal son. No. Life is an investment of God in each and every one of us. And everyone that gets, for those of us who are here who are into business, we know that when you invest, you expect a return. The Bible says in Ephesians 2, verse 10, for we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So you will note in that verse of the scripture two things. God created you. You are not an accident, not just a statistic. You didn't come by the Darwin's evolutionary theory. No, you didn't evolve from monkeys or baboons. God created you, and he made you for a purpose. And God has a plan for you. He has a purpose for your life. That's why he says in Jeremiah 29:11, I know the thoughts I have towards you, they are thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you hope and a future. That purpose for each person is determined by God alone. And he alone judges the success or otherwise in the pursuit or achievement of the purpose. Nobody was born just to exist and then pass on. No one should be as such. Or like Methuselah, who lived 969 years, and all he did was procreate. You can see that in Genesis 5:27. I was so glad listening to the tributes about our darling sister. She lived purposefully. And I think that's what we should take away today. Her daughter said she lived intentionally, and she was intense about everything she did. That's how you know somebody who is a person of purpose. They are intentional and they do everything with intensity. There's no happenstance, no accident, no, it just happened, no. Everything was deliberate. All of us, every one of us was made for a purpose, born for a purpose. But guess what? Not everybody fulfills purpose. I pray that all of us sitting down here today will fulfill purpose in Jesus' mighty name. I say a better amen. For example, the purpose for Jesus' birth is salvation of mankind. The Bible tells us in Matthew 1:21, it says, you will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin. Salvation of mankind. And as was mentioned by our sister, 33 and a half years, he fulfilled it. And he died fulfilling it, because going to that cross was a fulfillment of the purpose. Was it easy? No. But he did it. And that's why those of us who know him now are saved. And we can say we are saved and we have a hope of heaven. Apostle Paul, the writer of the most part of the New Testament, had his purpose outlined for him. If you look at Acts chapter 9, the encounter he had on the road to Damascus. And the purpose was, take the gospel to Gentiles. You and I were Gentiles. Well, we didn't know Christ. We're Gentiles. But for Apostle Paul, we would have remained Gentiles and would have been without hope. His purpose was to take the gospel to the Gentiles and suffer persecution for the sake of Christ. He had the purpose clearly, he knew it, and he went for it intensely and intentionally. Apostle Paul suffered. He said, everything I achieved, he said, I cast as dung. He said, for the purpose of the gospel. In his days, he was an elite. He was a lawyer. He was both Greek and he was both Greco-Roman, at the same time a Jew. And in both, he excelled. He excelled as a Roman in law. He excelled as a Jew in Pharisee, as a Pharisee. And he suffered for the gospel. In fact, he did something that, you know, every time I read it, I said to myself, God, give me the grace to be able to make this confession when my time is up. Because for each and every one of us, our time will be up one day. He says, I have run my race. I have fought a good battle. I have finished my course. Very interesting. How can a man say that? He was so sure. Why? Because he knew the purpose. I have fought a good fight. I've finished the race. Say, now it's laid for me a crown. It's like you went to do an exams, and you were so sure of your performance, and you say, I'm expecting an A asterisk. So we're all born for a purpose. And it's important that we get to know that purpose so that we might pursue it intensely, intentionally, and achieve it. I have no doubt that our sister that we've come to celebrate today, our mother, wife, she did that. She pursued intensely. And by the grace of God, she achieved. And I'm so encouraged, I must say, by her daughter's tributes. It was a message to me. Number two thing I want us to note is that there's a set timeline for the purpose to be achieved. We don't have the entire world. And I like what she said also too. Who says it has to take 100 years to accomplish the purpose? Jesus Christ achieved the main purpose why you and I have hope today. Salvation, 3.5 years. In fact, the ministry was for 3.5 years, and he got it done. It's a set timeline. Ecclesiastes 3:2 says, a time to be born and a time to die. Between those two ends, purpose must be fulfilled. The timeline is determined by God, and that's why he owes nobody no explanation. No, he didn't ask to create anybody, and he doesn't ask also to take when he feels, when he knows his time or the appointed time he has made. The Bible says in Hebrews 9:27, say it's appointed for man to die once, and after that, judgment. At the expiration of the timeline comes the home call, whether or not the purpose was fulfilled. No overtime. It's like an exam. Whether you wrote it, whether you happened to write or not, when the time is set, from the beginning of it, at the end of it, whether your paper is filled with answers or whether it's empty, the examiner cares less. He just takes the paper and says, time up. Let me say this also too. When the time for the home call comes, when the bell tolls, the mode of passage is not determined by anyone. It's not prescribed by anyone. How a person leaves this world, there is no way it's prescribed. The Bible doesn't tell us anything about that. God determines that. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ died on the cross. And the Bible says in Hebrews 12:2, he said he despised the shame of dying on the cross. It was a shameful thing in those days to die on the cross. That was how he died. John the Baptist, a forerunner of Jesus Christ, was beheaded. James was executed by Herod, was executed. Peter too was executed on the cross. Apostle Paul, with all the work he did, was executed. He was beheaded by the Roman Emperor Nero. Elisha, a man that had a double portion of the fiery Elijah, he died with a sickness. In fact, the Bible tells us, if you look at 2 Kings 13, verse 21, when he died, where they buried him, some people were carrying a corpse to go and bury around that area, and they saw a band of some foreign people coming to attack Israel. They dumped the corpse of that person on Elisha's tomb, and the person rose up. So it means that even at death, anointing was still there. But he died because his purpose was fulfilled. When purpose is fulfilled, as far as God is concerned, the person comes home. That's why it says, the righteous die, and nobody takes it to heart. Not knowing that God takes away the righteous to spare them from the evil to come. Elijah was translated by chariot of fire. So the mode of exit from this world is not prescribed. And it's not for us to start making conjectures, to start saying, oh, is this, oh, it's not up to us. God determines that. And he doesn't speak anything as to whether the purpose was achieved or not. So does the matter of death or the reason for the death says nothing to the purpose regarding the fulfillment or otherwise, provided the person died is not suicide. Because suicide is not permitted, even scripturally. You cannot kill. You are not allowed to kill. And you cannot even kill yourself. The next thing I want you to know, people of God, is God sets the time of home call and owes no one an explanation. When that time is determined by him and he makes it to happen, even in it, he says we should give thanks. And guess what? Where, when, how, we don't know. Ours is to come to this world, seek that purpose, know it, and pursue it intensely and intentionally. You know, people who pursue purpose intensely and intentionally, they don't see obstacles. They see opportunities where other people see challenges. It's exactly what our sister, Mrs. Alakija, just said about her mom. Every other person will see challenges. They will say, don't do that. They will go for it. They don't share the same passion with other people. They have their own focus. They are focused people. And thus we know one thing. Death is thus not the end. It is a vehicle of transition from one realm to the other. This is the reason we are enjoined not to sorrow as those without hope. Jesus Christ was speaking to Martha and Mary in John 11, 25, 26. John 11, verses 25 and 26. He says, hey, I am the resurrection and the life. He said, believe in me, even though you die, you live. So what has happened is transition. Death is a vehicle of transition. When I was growing up here in Lagos, I won't tell you my age, but in those days in Surulere, we went on our drive, we have our group, we say, a man die, man rot. No. There's a life after. Vehicle is a means of, death is a means of transportation from this realm to the other realm. My question to you is this. Do you know your purpose? And I ask it respectfully. Are you passionate in the pursuit of your purpose? Because you don't know the day or the time of the home call. You don't know when the bell will toll. And what are you doing about it? In some hearts, some questions are being asked towards me right now. How do I know? How can I find or how do I know my purpose? You cannot find or know your true purpose without a relationship with your Creator, the Almighty God. Because it is during your relationship with Him that you will find your purpose. He will reveal it to you. But not only that, He will equip you to achieve it by grace. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, it says, then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you came out of the womb, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. That was Jeremiah's purpose. And it was set before he was born. God knew all of us before we were ever even born. The Bible says he had plans for us before the foundations of the world. That is, before he said, let there be light, in Genesis chapter 1. He knew all of us. Plans for our lives. Why we are here today, he knew. Event of today, all written down. Purpose. It is in the midst. It is while you are relating with God that he will reveal the purpose. The Bible says in Acts 13, verse 2, it says, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. And I said to myself, if they were not fasting and praying, and I'm not asking you to fast and pray right now, there are ways you don't have to get into fasting and praying to know God's purpose for your life. In worship, he can reveal it to you. Fasting and prayer is good. Don't get me wrong. As Christians, we should do it if you're a Christian. And even many other religions, they do it as well. God said, by the Holy Spirit, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Up till that time, they didn't know the work for which he had called them. It was in the course of relating with God in worship that purpose was declared to them. Apostle Paul, when he finished, says, I have run my race and finished my course. Now there's a crown waiting for me because the purpose was clear. And yet you cannot ask God that purpose except through Jesus Christ. I say that boldly. I say respectfully, but I say without apologies. In John 14:6, Jesus Christ said, may that declaration. He says, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. He said it categorically. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to God the Father except by me. And that means you want to know purpose for which the Creator created you. You come to Him. You come through Jesus Christ, the only door. Without relationship with God, purpose becomes unknown. Without the pursuit of God-given purpose and fulfillment thereof, life is a wasted time and a wasted investment of God. And I pray sincerely from my heart that none of us in this place, sitting down here today, part of this event, will live a wasted life in Jesus' mighty name. You will not live a wasted life in Jesus' mighty name. Life is an investment of God in you for a purpose. I begin to close. It's a dangerous thing not to fulfill purpose. In Mark 11, 12 to 15, Mark 11, 12 to 15, Jesus Christ was passing by a tree. He was approaching a tree, a fig tree, the Bible says. And he was expecting to find fruit on it because the leaves and the way the fig tree presented was that as though it had fruit. I would imagine it was covered with leaves. Jesus Christ got there and there was no fruit. He cursed it. And I believe the Bible records that bit of it for a purpose for us. God has expectation. For that tree, Jesus Christ had expectation. You ought to be producing fruit. You presented as if you had fruit. The resources given to you to produce fruit, to benefit others, you use it for yourself to have good leaves. It says, no man will take fruit from you again. And the tree dried up. It won't be our portion in Jesus' mighty name. In Luke 13, verse 6 to 9, something happened there. And it's a parable for us to pick from as well. A man approached his gardener and said, this tree has been here 3 years and has produced no fruit. He says, in the Bible language, King James Version, he says, it cumbers the land, that is, it's wasting space. It's just occupying space. The purpose for which it was planted is not being fulfilled. It's not producing fruit. Cut it down. Cut it down. When purpose is not fulfilled, I pray that God will not cut us down in Jesus' mighty name. Purpose. That we will not just occupy the space that God has given us to fulfill a purpose. That like our sister, whose home call today, we are celebrating and not mourning. I like what her son said the first time he came to speak. It's not the time to mourn, no. She had a glorious home call. Because we know, from all that had been said, she lived for a purpose. She went for it. She went hard for it. And when the time came, she wasn't afraid to go. In the parable of the talent, in Matthew 25, verse 14 to 30, just also to underscore that God invests in us a life that he has given us to accomplish his own purpose for our lives. We know that story. The man that was given 10 talents, 5 talents, 2 talents, and then 1 talent. Five talents, 2 talents, and 1 talent. And they all doubled theirs except the one who was given one. And he went and buried it. Is there something, a purpose that will be a benefit to mankind that God had invested in you to fulfill? And you are somewhere there keeping quiet. I'm going my own way. I don't want to trouble anybody. Nobody troubles me. I'm just doing my own stuff. It's just like that servant who was given just one talent. And he said to the master when he came to ask for returns on his investment, because the money was given to them for invest as an investment, go and trade with it and come back to me with interest on it. The one with five came back, had doubled it to 10. The one with two came back and doubled it to 4. The one with one came back and said, I know you are a hard man. You gave me only one, and you reap where you don't sow. So I went, I dug the ground, I put it there. This is your investment. And the owner and the rich man said, what? You couldn't even invest it and give me a return? You just went and buried it? And see, it was thrown into darkness. There'll be mourning, crying, and gnashing of teeth. May I say to you, ladies and gentlemen, when purpose is fulfilled, there is a reward. When purpose is missed and not fulfilled, there are harsh consequences. And Jesus Christ explained that with the parables of the fig tree that was cursed, of the fig tree that was cumbering the land and was going to be cut off, and with the man that was given the talent and went and buried it. Are you burying the talent today? That should be of benefit for people. There's a purpose for you being in this event. You didn't come here by chance. There are people who were invited, I'm sure, were not able to make it. But God made it possible for you to make this event. And I urge you not to leave this event without making a resolve in your heart to know your purpose in life, and by so doing, come into relationship with God through Jesus Christ. But I know we will not be at all the same level. Some people already probably have a sense of their purpose, and they're already chasing it. For those ones, I will say, sharpen your focus on your purpose, drive harder, get more intense, and pursue with all passion and vigor. You know, that's why in the past I used to wonder how come we could take photographs with some cameras that don't have this extended I'm not a photographer, so I don't know. But I understand from a friend who is into photography. And he said to me, it's sharper. So when I attach that extra one to it, it gives me a sharper focus. If you already know your focus, if you already know your purpose, sharpen your focus. Give it more energy. Drive at it with more passion. If you don't know your focus yet, if you don't know your purpose yet, get a focus today. Make a resolve in your heart to get that focus today. But there are cases where people already have, they know the purpose. They were focused on it, but also too, they were distracted. And I used to be there. I knew what God wanted me to do, but I was distracted until, by the grace of God, I was redirected. So today, we know that God determines the time that anyone will leave this world. And a life well spent, you know, we say, to the glory of God, for a life well spent, this happened. A life well spent, indeed, is a life spent in the pursuit and fulfillment of the Creator's purpose, a God-given purpose. That's a life well spent. It is not how long, but how well. In living and fulfilling God's purpose for our lives. I said earlier, the only way to get to know purpose is to relate with the Creator, the Almighty God. And John 14:6, Jesus Christ says to us, you cannot come to him except by me. except through me. You want to know purpose? You can only come to God to seek it because he's your maker. You know about an appliance by what exactly the manufacturer had put in the manual for you to read about it. Your purpose is known by your creator, because before the world was founded, he already outlined it. I'm sure looking at the gathering sitting down here, it's not news to you. When I go to preach in the rural areas, in the shanties, you know, and the shacks, I tell them, and it seems new to them, but you all know very well that none of us sitting down here today, if we're all to thumbprint, nobody shares the same thumbprint with another person. That's why it's the only way of identifying. We are unique to God, and we are unique also too in our callings. We are unique in our purpose. You have a purpose. Do you know the purpose? Are you fulfilling the purpose? Are you in pursuit of that purpose? Our sister, Mrs. Shefola, she fulfilled purpose from the tributes that we have had. And we want to be able to get to meet her when we get there on that day and say, we meet again. When a Christian dies, it's not goodbye. It's bye-bye, because we will see again. I want to ask if you would like to make that connection with the Almighty God today through Jesus Christ. And I say boldly, I won't give you a sense of who I was, but there was nothing about me 30 years ago that says I will stand as a pastor and preach. I was the farthest from it. The circles in which I moved, the company I kept, the things I did, the kind of places I was found, nothing pointed to what and where I am today. Sometimes when I try to share the gospel with my father, he would look at me and say, do you know how many times I had to beat you to go to church with me? Do you know how many times I had to force you and I have to tell you to go and dress properly to come to church with me? And so you preach the gospel to me now. I say, well, you see what God can do. If you are here, I say it again respectfully, and you want to make that connection today with the Almighty God, your Creator, through Jesus Christ, the opportunity beckons to you today. And sometimes it's a once in a lifetime opportunity. I want to just bow your heads and I'll pray with you. I know that those who are organizing this program are well known to all of us. They might have been the one who invited us, and you might want to connect with them. Normally, we would have had a way to connect with you right here and share some things with you. But I'll just say, let's bow our heads as we pray. Our Father and our God, we want to say thank you to you for the opportunity to share this word today. It is not by accident that this word is coming to us, both to the speaker and to the hearers. First, Lord, I pray that having preached and having heard this word today, we will not just be hearers alone, nor preachers alone, but we will be doers also too in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I pray, my Father and my God, that we will not live here. None of us will live here today without a change happening. Because you say to us in Isaiah 43:19, you say you do a new thing. And you do it in different dimensions. I pray, my Father and my God, that you reveal your purpose for each and every one of us. That everyone, oh Lord, today who has been under my voice will not leave this place without connecting with you, without having a sense of the purpose for which you created them and for which you have spared their lives up till now. We are not better than anyone who had passed. We have not lived holier than anyone. Neither have this sin more than we have done. We are alive because there's still something for us to accomplish. And we are better off being working on that thing right now than being idle or being away from it or being distracted. Lord, reveal the purpose. Where you have revealed the purpose, Lord, give us more grace to pursue with more intensity and more passion, O Lord, and to accomplish before we come to meet with you. Where the purpose is not known, Lord, I pray that, Lord, today there will be a connection with you through Jesus Christ. And I pray, Lord, that you will, O Lord, reveal, because you are faithful. You are faithful, Lord. You say we should ask, we should seek, and we should find. And you say we should ask because you will answer. You say, ask of me, and I will show you. That as many as are asking you this hour, that you reveal purpose to them, O Lord, that they don't come to meet with you empty-handed, that they don't come to meet with you ashamed. That, Lord, you will reveal that purpose in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. As many as are seeking to connect with you today, I pray that, Lord, you will have mercy, that you will forgive, that you will make hope, and that you will adopt into your family in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, our Father and our God. Blessed be your name, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we are prayed. Amen. I would also like to, I know there will still be a prayer for this, but I just want to also thank God for the family of the Shofolas. I thank the Lord for already what he has in you demonstrated to us, which is a lesson to someone like me, and I'm sure many who have heard today. I pray that we're going to strengthen you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. There is a grace that God gives one. My mom and my wife passed in space of 8 months. There was nothing anybody could say, that really hit me properly than what God whispered to me himself. And that's the comforting aspect of the Holy Spirit's interaction. Now I pray that you will experience that in Jesus' mighty name. When you look back and say to yourself, how are we going to do this? If she was alive, she would have done this. God will fill that vacuum in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. He will make himself available to you even more than ever before in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. He has not done it to hurt you. Someone said, I will be asking God why. Well, maybe you heard a bit of the why. She has fulfilled her course. She has finished her race. And her owner, her creator, has called her to be with himself. And we cannot ask him, why did you do that? He is sovereign. The Lord will comfort you. The Lord will keep you. The Lord will strengthen you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. God bless you.
Now, because our time is far spent, we're going to change the order of the program. We will now take the hymn, How Great Thou Art. And that thereafter, we will invite Pastor Isaac Ogboide to pray for the family. And then Kolade would deal with the vote of thanks, and then Pastor Nathaniel will then come back to for a special ministration, and then we will close. So can we be upstanding as we take the hymn, How Great Thou Art?
Sings my soul, my Savior.
Sit whilst the immediate family remain standing, as the immediate family, can you please stand as Pastor Ogude prays whilst we all sit.
Praise the Lord. What a great evening we've had. I will not go through what different speakers have said, but Auntie was also special to me. When she returned from the United Kingdom after the burial of Sister Bokayode, she mentioned something to me, that there was a particular message that she liked in terms of funeral ceremonies. As if that was not enough, 3 days later, she called me again to repeat the same thing. And here I am, not just to pray for the family, but was requested to anchor the Saturday funeral ceremony. Did she know I was going to do that? The Almighty God that we serve will keep you in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for, could the family please close their eyes, please, as I pray from the throne of grace. Father, we thank you for the life of our sister, our mother, our auntie, Darling Osayon Boshofela Ni Giwa Osage. We thank you for the life she lived here on earth before calling her home. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, that in all things we should give thanks, for that is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us.
And in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, it says, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavily laden, that I will give you rest. The Almighty God will give you rest in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I present the family members of your daughter into your able hands. The husband, Uncle Kayode, the son, Kolade, Jumon, Bukola, Ladiko, the grandchildren, Ladiko, Tirani, Kolakwa, Koinsola. Father, please continue to be their God. Continue to be their guide. Father, please fill the wide vacuum created by the exit of Mrs. Shofola to this family. She was a coordinator, a rallying point among others. We know she'll be greatly missed. Father, please be their refuge. The Lord will be your fortress. The Almighty God will order your steps. The Holy Spirit will comfort you. He will cover you in the hollow of his hands. You will not fail. You will not fall. You will not falter. Every evil arrow targeted at you will go back to sender in the mighty name of Jesus. Ogun ile, ogun ode, koni pa yin o. Ogun akoba, ogun adaba, e o ni ri. E o ni silewo o. E o ni ri ogun gbami gbami. Iku ojiji koni de ba yin. To saraye wa ba o. To sara gbebe guwa. Iyawo e dan yin lawa wa. Umo umo me, e wa hia ka mu ayo. Keye kihe wa hera ma ke na bie na ke na ma bie wa hia wa iso wa ofu egbe e wa hia ya so wa o. The Almighty God that we serve will wipe away your tears. The peace of the Almighty God that passeth all understanding shall be your portion in the mighty name of Jesus. This death will not lead to another death in this family. No power is permitted to cut your life short. You will have fulfilled purpose. You fulfill destiny in the mighty name of Jesus. For all those who have traveled, I decree in the name that is above every other name, you will return back home safely in the mighty name of Jesus. There will be no accident. There will be no kidnapping. Father, I commit the rest of the services pertaining to this funeral into your hand, O Lord. They will all be successful in the mighty name of Jesus. It will be well with you. It will be well with all that concerns you. Goodness will follow you. Mercy will follow you throughout the days of your life. In the presence of the enemy, you continue to succeed. Thank you, eternal King of glory. Glory and honor be to your holy name. In Jesus' matchless name, we have prayed. Praise the Lord.
A vote of thanks.
Hallelujah. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. So I'll give thanks. First of all, I'll give thanks to God, the Almighty God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the Creator of the worlds. No will is above your will. Thank you, God, for our mother's life. We've spoken so much about purpose. If my mother didn't live a life of purpose, I don't think anybody else did. She lived hard, worked hard, played hard, prayed hard, loved hard. So I'm going to try to do what 1 Thessalonians 4, I believe, says, which is, do not grieve as the heathens grieve. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to cry, because God knows I've cried a lot of tears. But it does mean that I know where my mother is. I know she is in the bosom of the Lord. So For that reason, I give thanks to Almighty God. I give thanks to God for all the distinguished guests here. I give thanks to God for my family. I give thanks to the officiating ministers, Ms. Pastor, Mr. Jide Koku, SAN. Thank you so much for being an uncle. Pastor Oye Igbemo, thank you so much, sir, for sharing your lessons, the real lessons of your life, and how they translate into scripture, and for us to share, and empowering us, encouraging us. Thank you, Pastor Ogbede, for your wonderful prayer. No weapon formed against you shall prosper, in Jesus' name. I thank my family, my Uncle Sato, my wonderful uncle. He's been there with us through all of this. He knows the pain that we share. I mean, sometimes it was almost as though we had to comfort him, not comfort ourselves. Thank you so much, Uncle. Blessings be upon you, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Uncle Moody Amir, Uncle Sargwe, Auntie Wari, praying for us with that stern steel. Uncle Saraba, SAN, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Am I missing anybody? Uncle Saitin, God bless you, Uncle. Auntie Bisola, Uncle Akin. No, I'm coming there. The captain, thank you, sir. Mr. Fix-It, if you don't know how to fix it, you know who fixes it, who knows how to fix it. God bless you. Auntie Shade Ogundare, I really don't know where you get the selfless energy from. God bless you, ma. Sister Funke, Zafiro Events, God bless you for coordinating all of this while you gave us a chance to actually get ourselves together and putting together such a beautiful event. The Awolowos, thank you. And Pastor Natalia Bassi, we can't say enough about, you know, Pastor Nathaniel. Our family, my mother and I, we just shared a deep love for his music, you know. Obviously inspired by God. When I hear his music, it's like, I imagine that's what David was like when he was inspired to write, you know, Psalms and all of that. I see Uncle Richard. Thank you so much, Uncle, for coming. Thank you to all my mother's friends and all the attendees that came through today, even with the risk of, you know, COVID, but no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Thank you so much for coming. And thank you to my beloved family, to my dad, our rock, showing us what relationship, what love is. Thank you so much. Thank you to my brother, Juwan, my sister, Buki, Ladipo. You guys are the pillars of my house. You know, God is my foundation, but you are the pillars that hold it up. And obviously, my in-laws, Natalie, Larry. Thank you so much. God bless you. Thank you, Mom. I just have to say thank you. You know, I'm not going to speak like a heathen speak, as though she was not present here with us. Look at your beautiful smile, and I mean, look at that smile. You know what she's thinking. She wants to go for something, and she wants to fill the place with love. Thank you so much, Mom, for living a life that I only pray and hope to emulate. With that said, I'll close the vote of thanks and say God bless all of you. In Jesus' name, God bless and guide you. Amen.
Now, I'm going to invite Pastor Nathaniel Bassi for another ministration, and then he would also take the benediction. I also have a message for you in terms of the protocol.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Because of the COVID-19 protocol, Please, after Nathaniel Abasi, Pastor Nathaniel Abasi's ministry, the shofolas will sit down in this reserve area because of the COVID-19 protocol. We will appreciate if you don't have physical contacts. And we come from this side, and you can bow, greet, wave, or what you want to do, and pay courtesy to them, and you can exit from this way. We really appreciate you. Thanks for coming. And those online, we thank you very much. God bless you all, and God keep all of us. Thank you in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to be ending my ministry doing something I do very scarcely, you know, for people, but I reserve exclusively for the Lord. After singing two or three songs, I'm just going to sound my trumpet, you know, just, you know, imitating what's happening in heaven, heralding a saint who has just come home. And when we do that, just, you know, respond with hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Can we rejoice? Can we sing to the Lord? Can we stand? Is it okay? This song just says, Olorun Agbaye, the God of the universe, the one who is sovereign in everything and over everything. Yeah, 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 yeah. Mighty God, mighty God. Oh, you are good, you are kind, you are more than these. Lost for words, trying to describe you. Elohim, Elion, Alishelewi. Your greatness is all I see. There is nothing you cannot do. There's no mountain you cannot move. If you have said it, then you will do it. You have a track record of keeping your word. The blood that you shed, we have overcome. This charge that I'm greeted for life, for life. Then you gave us the right to your holy name. The scepter of power and strength. There is 7 says, and he will come with clouds, and every eye will see him, even those that pierced him, and inhabitants of the earth will wail because of him. Amen. The king is coming. Tell somebody, the king is coming. Our king is coming. That's good news. So I'll just sing this song. The king is coming in glory. Every eye will see.
Every eye will see the King.
Oh, the King is coming
in glory and in majesty.
Every eye will see.
Every eye will see the King.
Tell the world the King is coming
in glory and in majesty.
Hey, every
Hallelujah.
bless you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. The Holy Spirit, rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Check. Mic check.
When I am down and over, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart's burdened be, when I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. Raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than without its hunger. Each restless heart, not so blindly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. Raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy
to me so careful. Spirit.